Nehemiah chapter 3. Then Elisha, the high priest, rose up with his brothers, the priests, and they built the sheep gate. They consecrated it and set its doors. They consecrated it as far as the Tower of Hundred, as far as the Tower of Hananel. And next to him, the men of Jericho built. And next to them, Zakur, the son of Imri, built. The sons of Hasanah built the fish gate. They laid its beams and set its doors, its bolts, and its bars. And next to them, Meremoth, the son of Uriah, son of Hakaz, repaired. And next to them, Meshulam, the son of Berechiah, son of Meshezabel, repaired. And next to them, Zadok, the son of Baanah, repaired. And next to them, the Tekoites repaired, but their nobles would not stoop to serve their lord. Joiada, the son of Paseah, and Meshulam, the son of Besodiah, repaired the gate of Yeshanah. They laid its beams and set its doors, its bolts, and its bars. And next to them repaired Melatiah, the Gibeonite, and Jadon, the Meronothite, the men of Gibeon and of Mizpah, the seat of the governor of the province beyond the river. Next to them, Uzziel, the son of Hariah, goldsmiths, repaired. Next to him, Hananiah, one of the perfumers, repaired, and they restored Jerusalem as far as the broad wall. Next to them, Rephaiah, the son of Hur, ruler of half the district of Jerusalem, repaired. Next to them, Jediah, the son of Harumaph, repaired, opposite his house. And next to him, Hattush, the son of Hashabniah, repaired. Malkijah, the son of Harim, and Hashub, the son of Pahath Moab, repaired another section of the Tower of the Ovens. Next to him, Shalum, the son of Halohesh, ruler of half the district of Jerusalem, repaired, he and his daughters. Hanun and the inhabitants of Zanoah repaired the valley gate. They rebuilt it and set its doors, its bolts, and its bars, and repaired 1,000 cubits of the wall as far as the dung gate. Malkijah, the son of Rechab, ruler of the district of Beth Hakaram, repaired the dung gate. He rebuilt it and set its doors, its bolts, and its bars. And Shalum, the son of Kolhozeth, ruler of the district of Mizpah, repaired the fountain gate. He rebuilt it and covered it and set its doors, its bolts, and its bars. And he built the wall of the pool of Shelah of the king's garden, as far as the stairs that go down from the city of David. After him, Nehemiah, the son of Azbuk, ruler of half the district of Bethzer, repaired to a point opposite the tombs of David, as far as the artificial pool and as far as the house of the mighty men. After him, the Levites repaired. Rehum, the son of Bani. Next to him, Hashabai, ruler of half the district of Keilah, repaired for his district. After him, their brothers repaired. Bavai, the son of Hanadad, ruler of half the district of Keilah. Next to him, Ezer, the son of Jeshua, ruler of Mizpah, repaired another section opposite the ascent to the armory at the buttress. After him, Baruch, the son of Zabai, repaired another section from the buttress to the door of the house of Eliashib, the high priest. After him, Meremoth, the son of Uriah, son of Hakaz, repaired another section from the door of the house of Eliashib to the end of the house of Eliashib. After him, the priests, the men of the surrounding area, repaired. After them, Benjamin and Hashub repaired opposite their house. After them, Azariah, the son of Maaseiah, son of Ananiah, repaired beside his own house. After him, Benui, the son of Hanadad, repaired another section from the house of Azariah to the buttress and to the corner. Palal, the son of Uzai, repaired opposite the buttress and the tower projecting from the upper house of the king at the court of the guard. After him, Padiah, the son of Parash, and the temple servants living on Ophel, repaired to a point opposite the water gate on the east and the projecting tower. After him, the Tekoites repaired another section opposite the great projecting tower as far as the wall of Ophel. Above the horse gate, the priests repaired, each one opposite his own house. After them, Zadok, the son of Immer, repaired opposite his own house. After him, Shemaiah, the son of Shechaniah, the keeper of the east gate, repaired. After him, Hananiah, the son of Shelemiah, and Hanun, the sixth son of Zalaf, repaired another section. After him, Mashalum, the son of Berechiah, repaired opposite his chamber. After him, Malachijah, one of the goldsmiths, repaired as far as the house of the temple servants and of the merchants, opposite the muster gate, and to the upper chamber of the corner. And between the upper chamber of the corner and the sheep gate, the goldsmiths and the merchants repaired.
Wow. Some of you, like, took a little catnap right there, right? How many people know that we're in the book of Nehemiah? Open your Bibles to Nehemiah. Go to the middle of your Bible and turn left a few chapters after the book of Psalms. And I know you're thinking, somebody just opened up the Hebrew Bible, or Hebrew phone book, actually, and read a bunch of names. And that just seems foreign to you, all of this. And by the way, I was thinking, how could I break up this sermon, and thought maybe I would leave this chapter out, and then realize that God's word is useful for all of us at every time. Even these ordinary words of lists of names that Nehemiah's keeping of people who built the wall. I think this message today is hugely important for us as a church. And I know that you're thinking, wow, chapter 3 of all the chapters, that would be the huge message. Imagine, by the way, if you built the wall and your name and your family name was in there. You think that you would own a Bible? Probably. And you'd show everybody your name is actually in there. Well, I'm so grateful that all Scripture is God-breathed. Say that with me, God-breathed. That means it's inspired by God. All Scripture, useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness. For what reason? So that the servant of God, that's you folks, may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. Turn to the person next to you and say, that was long, but God has a good work for you. That was long, but God has a good work for you. That means that even in the boring parts of the Bible, they have significance. We believe that God's word is Scripture. The Bible is His word to us, and everything is in there for a reason. Everything in the Bible is there to help equip the believer, to help you walk in God's purpose for your life with passion and encouragement, for you to accomplish what God has set you out to do within His mission. The key lesson of Nehemiah, God uses ordinary, somebody say, that's me. Ordinary people to make an extraordinary difference. In case you've missed the last few weeks, let me get you up to speed. If you're new here, you're like, what is this church all about? That was the longest thing ever. Well, again, just wait until I'm done with my sermon, okay? But we're gonna look at this as far as Nehemiah's approach. Nehemiah was just this ordinary guy who was a cupbearer. He was a servant to the king, Artaxerxes in Persia. He heard about the plight of his people, right, in Jerusalem. That he was a long ways away from his homeland, and they were in a horrible situation. Their city had been destroyed and burned down by the Babylonians, and the walls were in shambles. For 141 years, the walls in the city lay in ruins. 141 years, no one was able to come. But he saw his people in great distress, and he heard about this news. And Nehemiah's heart was broken. Broken for the things that would break God's heart. And we talked about that. What is God breaking in your heart? For the things of Him that He wants to accomplish through you. And you remember that He thought, well, you know, in this time of brokenness, he went to pray, right? His first response wasn't to get onto social media and complain. His first response was to pray to God, to weep and to pray over the situation. And God was working in his heart. We see that he is actually calling him to do something. For many of you, this has been my prayer for this book, that you would latch on to the very thing that God is trying to get your attention about, the thing that breaks his heart. Would break your heart and move you to make a difference. Listen, he prayed and fasted for 4 months. Now, I'm so happy. I'm so excited about our church because, you know what, 67 people prayed this last 24 hours. They made sure every hour was covered and then some. Awesome. So that means at least two people were praying for every... I'm not real good in math because I went to public school. But, you know, two people were praying, right? But, right? Is that right? Yeah, that's right. So here's the thing. Here's the thing. Some of you were praying at home and some of you were praying here. Some of you were praying late at night. Some of you early in the morning. Some of you right in the afternoon. And you dedicated yourself to prayer. There's a reason why we're asking you to pray in this season. God's best work is done in prayer. We think that it's getting us ready for ministry. Prayer is the ministry. Yes. It's when you get your heart right with God and you surrender to Him and say, God, I am no longer in charge of this thing. I realize that. Amen. My mess is really a mess, but I'm coming to you because I need help. And we're looking around us and we're seeing that the walls are broken down, folks, in our culture. And the church is asked to rise up. That's you. That's you. You say, me? Little old me? Yes. You. God wants to use you. And so like Nehemiah, He's asking for God's favor in this time of prayer. And then he approaches the king. And somebody say, uh-oh, right? He makes this audacious request. And he says, can I go back to my homeland? Can I do that and rebuild the city? And the king asks, well, how long do you need? And he gives him a time. The scripture doesn't say, but we know it took Nehemiah 12 years. Doesn't say he asked for 12 years, but can you imagine asking for time off? Well, what else? He also made the bold request. I also need wood from your personal forest. I also need official documentation. And I also need to get across the border safely. So he sent an army with him. And this is the crazy thing. The king granted his request. God's favor, God's hand, God's anointing was upon Nehemiah. And God wants to anoint some of you, put his hand upon some of you to do a greater thing than you even thought you could do. Amen. Because God works through ordinary people to do extraordinary things. And this is the crazy part. Nehemiah would use government resources to accomplish his task. Maybe you haven't thought about that. But it's interesting. So he set off to Jerusalem. He secretly goes there and he inspects the wall under the cover of night with some friends. He sees the gates at night. He assesses the situation. He sees reality with his own eyes, not just what he had heard on his social media feed. I know they didn't have that back then, you know. But he actually saw it with his own eyes and he came up with a strategic plan. And he went to the people and he asked, do you see the kind of trouble that we're in? Jerusalem lies in ruins and the gates are burned down. Do you see it? And I'm asking you as a church out in the courtyard here online, do you see the condition of our culture, of the world around us? Are you paying attention? Sometimes you feel the tension. Well, you need to pay attention when you feel the tension. There's something going on. We've got to wake up, folks, and stand up. And that doesn't mean take up arms necessarily, but our greatest weapon is prayer, Paul says in Ephesians, to go to the Lord in prayer. Then he told them about how God had given them favor, that he told the people, look, God has given me favor. He even given me favor with the king. And the people got real excited. And I almost imagine he's sort of like William Wallace in Braveheart, right? They can take away our lives, but they can't take away our... Okay, some people watch that. But okay, I just wanted to see. This is him. He's making the rally cry. And what do the people say? Let's go rebuild. Let's do it. Super excited. They're off on the journey. And this is where it leads us into chapter 3. You're saying, well, what does that have to do with us here at Gateway? God has given us a mission. Do you know that Jesus, when he left, he gave us the thing called the Great Commission. Sometimes it's the Great Omission, but it's the Great Commission. It's for us to, Matthew 28:18 says, then Jesus came to them. Who's them? The followers of Jesus, the disciples. And he said to them, all authority in heaven on earth has been given to me. Therefore, what? Go and make disciples. Listen, you want to know the mission? Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Hopefully next week we're going to have a baptism. Can't wait for that. That's going to be awesome. And then teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you, and surely I'm with you. I'm with you till the very end of the age. This is our mission. Listen, I've been in church ministry since the early 90s. I can't tell you how early because I'm old. I forgot. Some of those early days were awesome days. I had great excitement. And about 18 months into youth ministry, I wanted to quit. Some of you know what it's like. It's crazy in ministry, to work in ministry. I've seen a lot happen over the years, not as much as some of you have seen in church life. But I recognize that God has not called us to be this just easygoing houseboat situation here on this at this church. He has not called us to a cruise ship. He's not called us to be that. He's called us to be the aircraft carrier. I've told you that before. He's called us to be a lighthouse for those who are lost in the dark, who need the hope of the gospel of Jesus Christ and the truth of the gospel and the love of the gospel inside of them. That we'd be a lighthouse, that we would be a hospital, Lord, help me, be a hospital, Lord, for the broken and the hurting and the weary, and then to be this aircraft carrier. You come in on Sundays and we catapult you out to your mission field. You get stored up, you get the resources you need, and you head out. That's our mission. That's what we're to be about here in this church. Again, I've seen a lot of things. This is the crazy part about the church. It's an amazing enigma. An enigma inside a conundrum. Because it's full of people. Messy people. People who will hurt you, leaders who will do horrible things to some of you. And you felt that. You've been a part of that. And you're still here. It's amazing. God's grace gives you the ability to forgive. But what's really amazing is that God continues to use fallible people to lead his church. And this church, in many ways, in different parts of the world, is thriving. And I believe in this series that many of you, God is going to give you a divine burden. Jesus said this, I'm going to build my church. Who's going to build it? Jesus. And the gates of hell will not prevail against it. That's a declaration. How can he say that? All authority is given to him. And he wants to use you, but it takes us a submitted, surrendered person who says, God, no longer what I want, but what you want. Give me a burden. Give me something that upsets me so much that I have to do something about it. That's a dangerous prayer. Young person, you want to live for something more than what's on your feed, than what you're posting out there about how you look on the externals? Ask God to move in your heart and break your heart for what breaks his. And then look out, because he'll do it. He'll do it if you're honest to him. I know that because I sat in the pew just like you as a young person and said, God, what would you do with my life if I gave it to you? And I kept hearing like African drums in the background. And I said, no, no. And I ended up in Scotts Valley. Listen, God wants to move you in significant ways. He wants you to embrace this calling, but it often comes out of a deep pain. A passion that comes out of a deep pain becomes your great passion. And this is what happened to Nehemiah. His burden became his calling. I want you to look at this diagram that's on the screen. Again, this seems so ordinary and mundane, but when you look at the walls and the people involved, the people groups that are involved on the walls, notice how some people did more in terms of distance and more work on the walls. Others just had a little part, and they're sitting side by side, and notice each of the gates. You see all that up here, and you're kind of thinking, okay, well, this is nice. This is really neat to see, but you got the fish gate, and you got the sheep gate, and you got the valley gate, and the horse gate, and the water gate, and the dung gate. And yes, it's just like it sounds, the dung gate. That's where all the waste. I personally would like to live by the fish gate. I like to fish. But not by the dung gate. Do you know what I'm saying? Like, smelly, right? Some of you live on the slough in Watsonville. You know. Okay, anyway. So that's just me. The dung gate is a real place. I want to show you this. This is actually, in case you're like, does this really happen? Is this really? Yes, that's the dung gate in Jerusalem. That's off of Wikipedia, in case you wanted to know. It's right there. It's a real place. Because everything's real on Wikipedia. Everybody knows, right? What's crazy is that Nehemiah is inspiring those ordinary people to come along as one unit. To do God's work. And this is the type of people that he's working with. They weren't masonries and carpenters and builders and construction guys. They were goldsmiths and merchants and perfume makers. Now, how do you get a perfume maker to build a wall? Because see, I'm a pastor and I can barely put together the shed that I got at Lowe's. You know what I'm saying? How am I going to build a wall? Well, I want to give you some principles. And these are the principles I'm pulling out. I'm sure there's many more. From Nehemiah's principles for making the dream work, it has to do with teamwork. It has to do with working together. And I believe that these principles are applicable not just to our church right now, but to you in your business, in your home life, mom and dad, as you lead your kids, if you lead a team at school, if you lead anywhere, you have a place of influence, you can use these. First of all, making a difference begins with a personal commitment to God's plan. A personal commitment to God's plan. I love our church. We have some amazing people at our church. I come here early in the morning. There's people here getting set up. And there's many people here who are generous. There's people who are basically in every way. They're all in. They're a part of life groups. They are giving regularly. They're here every week. I mean, you throw the church up and they're there, right? And they're amazing. But I say that because some of you are halfway in. We have halfway or sort of in. People. And some of you are just barely in. You got a toe. You're checking it out. And again, half of those that come to Gateway come half the time. They don't come all the time. In fact, most of the folks, if we had everybody here, there'd be no place to sit if we came all at one time. So again, we see this, that many people, again, who aren't necessarily all the way in or just kind of putting their toe in, or about a third of our people serve regularly. Those are the regular folks. About a third of our people give regularly. What that means is that two-thirds don't serve anywhere here at Gateway in any shape or form. About two-thirds give very little, and some don't give at all. And folks, this isn't a time issue or a financial issue. This is a spiritual issue for our church. Now, if you're brand new at this church, just put me on mute for a second, okay? This isn't for you. I'm not setting myself either for those of you that are in the church and have been here for a while as judge. That's not my job. But my job is to encourage, to spur you on towards love and good deeds. And what I'm getting at is that for many, church is a spectator event. An event they attend rather than a community that they join and they're a part of, and a mission that they're committed to. And this isn't a message about giving, but let me just pause here on finances. Say, oh brother, just get it out. Oh brother, get it out. Sometimes you see exactly what people value. It's not sometimes, oftentimes. If I were to open up your bank or whatever you do, Venmo, and see what you're spending your expenses on, right? I can see what you value. And before you think like, oh man, this preacher's going to talk about money again. I knew it every time I go to church, the preacher talks about money. Jesus talked about money more than any other topic in the New Testament. He talked about money more than heaven and hell combined. There is a reason why. Because money is usually the most accurate measure of where your heart is. Now, I really got you. I got all of you now, right? Ouch. It shows you your priorities and what kingdom you're really serving. Now, I want you to think. Ultimately, again, if your thoughts are the church really must want my money and there's no way I'm giving to this place. Listen, I prefer that you hear this and respond by giving somewhere else. If we haven't gained your trust and you're saying, Ron, I know the F-150 that you drive, is that 2001 that has a transmission problem? I can't support that. I get it. Then support somewhere else, because it's more important for me that you be generous and have a generous heart than necessarily you get hung up on what I'm saying right now. Can you hear this with love? Can you hear it from a pastor who's trying to encourage you? Be generous. Be generous with your time and your talents, right? And your income, your treasure. Again, maybe one day we will earn your trust. I pray that we will. But again, until then, be a generous person. The question is, are you personally committed to God's plan? That's what I'm trying to get at. Are you personally committed to God's plan? Not just church on Sunday, but the rest of your life. The word commitment's interesting because I think sometimes we have a misunderstanding of what the word means. And then I think about all the parents who involve their kids in traveling teams. You want to talk about commitment? Oh my goodness. Have you seen the dollar signs that go out the door with traveling sports teams? And then all the other stuff that goes with it. I'm not looking at anybody particularly. But it's a lot. It's a commitment. And then when we talk about church life, people goes, I'm committed. Let me put it this way. Commitment is like this. If you had breakfast this morning, your bacon and eggs, because, you know, you don't have hot dogs, right? Bacon and eggs. Both the pig and the chicken contributed to your breakfast, but in different, very different ways. The chicken made a contribution. The pig was all in. They went all the way. Where are you? That's the question. Where are you in God's mission? Are you all the way in? Just making a contribution. Make a personal commitment to God's mission. You can see this personal commitment being worked out in the lives of the people in Nehemiah. They wanted to make a difference, and that difference starts with a personal commitment to God's plan. In chapters 1 and 2, we saw some extraordinary days with Nehemiah, but then in chapter 3, we see some very ordinary days, just a lot of hard work side by side. We think sometimes that the Bible, that's how we're supposed to live our lives, in extraordinary days. If you open up the book of Acts, it's like every page has some kind of miracle, awesome thing going on. There are actually 14 healing miracles in the book of Acts. 12 of those 28 chapters have a healing miracle in them. Extraordinary days. But we forget that sometimes when you turn the page in Acts, it's like a whole decade goes by. We forget that that book covers 30 to 35 years in church history. Lots of ordinary days to get to the extraordinary days. There's like 700 ordinary days for every one extraordinary day. And God uses all of them. He often uses the ordinary day to set up the extraordinary day. Did you know that somebody had to prepare this place before you came? Somebody had to put up chairs and pray for you before you came? Somebody had to put toilet paper in the bathroom. The lady said, amen. Okay, right? In the bathroom before you came, they cleaned this place. seem very ordinary for God to do the extraordinary. Nehemiah illustrates that God's work is hard work. Somebody say that with me. God's work is hard work. My dad used to say, son, if you ever want to pastor a big church, you got to get up in the morning. I don't want to pastor a church. I never told you that, Dad. I'm going back to bed. That was my response. You come back in 5 minutes later. Son, you want to ever pastor a big church? You got to get up in the morning. Dad, I'm not pastoring a church. Here I am, Dad. I know you're in heaven right now, but here I am. Thank you. By the way, again, did you know that God created you to work? God started, began, in the beginning. God worked. He created. And then he made a man who worked in the garden. I know that's hard to hear for some of you, but work is a spiritual thing. When you're surrendered to God, it's a sacred thing. Your work can be sacred when you say, God, it's because of you that I'm able to do this work, and so help me with all my might to do it. Colossians 3:23, Paul puts it this way, whatever you do it with all of your heart as working for the Lord, not for human masters, since you know that you will receive an inheritance from the Lord as a reward. It is the Lord Christ Jesus you are serving. Some of you need to know that bummer job that you're in, God has called you to that place to work for him. You think you're working for your boss, you're working for your boss's boss. You know what I'm talking about? Your Lord. And that's what you're working for. So making a difference requires hard work. Nehemiah accomplished what no one else was able to do, 141 years in just 52 days, 7 weeks, less than 2 months, 42 different people groups, 1.5 to 2 mile long in circumference this wall was, 3 to 4 feet thick, 15 to 20 feet high. And in Nehemiah 3, God is saying that these people were committed. They volunteered. They extended the kingdom of God by their commitment. And they preserved Jerusalem. They would build the wall and bring safety and joy and hope back into the city. Listen, God doesn't need a house, but his people do. This is why we're renovating our campus, so that God's people could come back together and enjoy worshiping God together, experience God's presence together. You can do it at home, but I'm telling you, the presence of God, there's nothing like it when God's people gather. Amen. And we enjoy that week in and week out, but we forget it came from hard work. Listen, it's not what you do. It's who you're doing it for. I think you would agree, we need more good preachers, right? Yeah, I wish we'd get one at Gateway. So, more good preachers, right? We need more good mechanics. I've recognized that. I got some cars, need work. Good, you know what I mean? Like spirit-filled engineers and roofers and plumbers and doctors and coaches and teachers and administrators and managers and lawyers and, yes, politicians. Who would love a spirit-filled politician? Yeah, a spirit-filled mechanic. Yes. Reminds me of the story of the pastor and the politician. I can't tell you if it's a true story or not, but they both ended up in heaven. And Peter's standing there, and the pastor shows up. Pastor, you were faithful all your ministry for years and years and years, like 50 years of your ministry. So let's take you into your home that Jesus has prepared for you. And you go over to this little, very small little hut of a house, and just a bed and a side table and one little lamp, and that's it. Very basic. One little door in, one little door out. He's like, oh, politician's watching all this. So then they go, the politician, he's like, sir, you made it to heaven. Enjoy this mansion. He's like a mansion with like 20-something rooms on this hillside, and he's even got an infinity pool. And the pastor's like, what is going on here? I mean, I don't get it. And then Peter's like, you know what? We've seen you in here almost every day. Your type in here, pastors come in here like clockwork. But this is the first time we've seen this guy. Sorry if that burns your biscuit, but hey. Listen, God wants you to know that your work is sacred, that you are here to serve him, to love him, and to know him. And this is why these people's names are recorded in the Bible. God was recognizing them for their hard work. Now, pause just for a minute. There's another dynamic I want you to see. And that is, how did they build the wall? They had some resource from the king, but they had to dig through the rubble. They had to dig through the rubble to build the wall. They redeemed the rubble by rebuilding the broken. And this is a principle for us, that we redeem, by God's hand, the rubble in people's lives to rebuild the broken. Someone needs to hear this today, because your life is a mess. You have made some horrible decisions. Bad choices. Some people would call you, in the Greek, idiota. Okay, that was Spanish. But just they would just say that you've made some dumb choices, that your life is in shambles. You're so much pain and so much regret. I'm not trying to make light of it. Listen, you may think you're done, but God is not done. Do not put a period where God put a comma. He's still working. And Jesus didn't come to give you some kind of advice or some kind of pep talk. He came for the comfort. He came to be the comforter to those who were broken. He came to be the doctor for those who were sick. He came to bind up the brokenhearted, to heal the sick, to set the captives free. And folks, some of that's you. And he does this by restoring you, by redeeming the broken pieces of your life. The word redemption, to redeem, to buy back. He redeems the broken pieces of your life. He buys you back personally, and then he takes the pieces of your life and he redeems them all that you thought was ashes. He builds something good. Christian, listen. If you've been in church life for a long time, dive deep into that truth that God is rebuilding with rubble. He's taking the things that were painful and hurtful, and he's making them good. All things he works together for our good. You may think, well, you know, I'm sort of one of those toe people. I'm kind of in. Like, I know I'm not perfect, but I live a pretty good life. I mean, I pay taxes. I treat my kids right. I recycle. I love most people. And listen, that kind of metrics does not work when it comes to being justified before God. You need to hear this. Some people here need to hear this. I'm sorry if it's a little stinging. Actually, I'm not, because I think the Lord wants you to hear this in your face even. Because God, before him, we are all sinners. Can we just get that clear? Say, you're really messed. No, don't do that. But we're all really messed up. We are broken to the core. Before God, that's who we are. Without the high priest of Jesus, we're sinners. There's no successful, high capacity, great potential sinners. And low capacity, unsuccessful sinners. We are all sinners. In case you think you've out-sinned me, if you only knew me. In case you think that you've out-sinned everyone in this church, think again. By the way, I want to say welcome home. Come back to Jesus. We're all hopeless, dead sinners. That's what the truth is. And again, you're in good company if that's how you feel about your life. And Jesus is revealing your sin to you. He's all done that to us, to each of us. And then we surrender to him and he starts doing this great work in us. And the gospel gives us hope beyond ourselves. God has redeemed our lives, and now we are called to be a part of his redemption plan by rebuilding the broken. It's hard, and it's really messy. But making a difference requires two things I want to show you here: leadership and unity. It's not the only things. It's out of this passage. Nehemiah is never mentioned. There is a Nehemiah mentioned in the list, but it's not Nehemiah, the same guy we've been reading about. It's another Nehemiah. That was a common name. He was a leader, Nehemiah was. He was calling the people to a greater mission, casting vision, casting the strategic plan. And someone once said that leadership was influence. And I love the John Maxwell books, and all those are very encouraging as a leader to read through. And while that's true, God often chooses his people to lead, and he chooses those people on different kinds of metrics than you and I would use. You and I, we might look at the resume and go, wow, impressive. God doesn't do that. Again, 1 Samuel 16, man looks on the outward appearance, but God looks at what? The heart. In God's kingdom, he chooses character over charisma. Not looks, not status, not money, but character. When God uses, he looks, when he works, when he uses leaders, he looks for that person who listens to the Spirit, the person who allows the Spirit to work through them. Somebody needs to hear this today, allowing the Spirit to work through you and listening to the Holy Spirit. That's what God's looking for, a heart that's turned towards him. Don't discount yourself. Ephesians 4, Paul tells us, this is how the church is supposed to go. Christ himself gave the apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, the pastors, the teachers, verse 12, to equip his people for works of service. So what is the job of a pastor in this verse? I don't know. I can't really. Oh, it's on the screen. Let's see. To equip his people. To equip his. To what is it?
To equip
Okay, what does equip mean? It means to set a broken bone. It means to get the nets ready for a fishing trip. It means to get the ship ready to sail. What that means is that pastors are to equip, and the ministers are truly the members in the body. I want to commission those of you who are Christ followers, every single one of you. You are a missionary. Wherever you go this week, you are bringing Jesus with you, because he lives inside you. He's put his deposit of his Holy Spirit in you. And now you are to be his mouthpiece wherever you are. You are the one. I know we get this mixed up. Some people say, well, Ron, what is it like? What is it like to be a pastor? What's that really like? Because some of you think, you know, again, I eat angel food cake every day, and I watch Highway to Heaven reruns, while some of you have deviled ham and watched, Bad Company or whatever that is. Anyway, the bottom line is that it is sort of like, well, do you have kids? You have kids?
Yes.
You know what it's like. Do you have teenagers? You really know what it's like. Do you have adult kids living at home? You really know what it's like. Now, do you have cats? If that doesn't work for you, do you have cats? When was the last time you could get your cat to do what you really wanted them to do? I mean, come on. That is pastoring. To try to get people to do what it is that they really don't want to do, but what God's calling us to do. That's why they say leadership is like herding cats. That's why they say that. Again, one of our greatest issues and biggest problems is division. Two visions. Division instead of one. It's disunity. And we're facing it right now. It will be faced tomorrow and the next day and the next day. The enemy loves to divide the church. And it happens when you reach broken people. It happens when you reach the de-churched people. It happens when you reach unchurched people. Because there'll be differences in political views. There'll be difference in financial issues and lifestyles and cultural issues. But unity in the Bible is not uniformity. We aren't all to look the same. Where everybody in the church looks the same, that's not unity, right? You got that? It's unity is coming together with all the differences that we do have. The biblical vision of the church, the New Testament church, is to be a place, again, where not everybody agrees on everything. That's not it. It's where Jesus is so large and the gospel is so big that all those secondary issues are non-issues.
Amen.
Jesus is raised high, his love and his grace and his truth and his ability to give conviction to those about the gospel, huge. That's important for us. And letting that be the lens through which everything else we see. That's why we will never back down ultimately from preaching the truth of God's word. I may be out of the pulpit, but I know from our elders, we will always teach the truth of God's word with love.
Amen.
With grace and truth moving forward. We're not going to be unapologetic. We are going to be unapologetic. We're not going to go around apologizing. I've caught myself recently to say, oh, I'm sorry for saying God's word. No, I shouldn't say that. I'm giving you what I know to be best and true to God's word and the conviction he's stirring up in me. Listen, we will stand for the sanctity of life. That's PRC. We will stand for the sanctity of marriage. We will stand up for God's design for sexuality and gender, and we'll continue doing that. And other unpopular things, by the way, even if it makes you mad and you leave.
Amen.
Because we'd rather be right with Jesus and really come back to the truth of the word and rest on him. Two visions become a division. One vision, Lord, from the Lord. Nehemiah 3:32 says, Uzziel, son of Harihah, I don't know if that's really how you say it, but one of the goldsmiths repaired the next section, and Hananiah, one of the perfume makers, made the repairs in that next one. And then verse 8 says, back there on verse 8, it says merchants made repairs. So I'm pointing out to you here, goldsmiths, perfume makers, merchants, all working on the wall, right next to each other, side by side. You think they had any disagreements? Oh, yeah. Where there's people, there's friction, right? That's why we need the oil of the Holy Spirit to help us as we move along swiftly, just like the New Testament. All kinds of skill levels need lots of supervision, by the way. My dad used to do this mission work with people, and they would come, like retired engineers and others, to the church to try to help them. But they would come and do a building program, and an engineer just with a building program, this doesn't work. I mean, an accountant trying to work on studs in a wall, and all of a sudden you're supervising them a lot because the studs are like, you know. This is what's happening with Nehemiah. Why does he do that? He wants them to own it. He wants them to be a part of the project because he's not hiring it out. He wants them to be personally involved. So he sees a unifying vision carried out by a coordinated plan. That's the next principle, a unifying vision carried out by a coordinated plan. Nehemiah had to work a lot on coordination. Some of you are very uncoordinated. Amen. If we asked you to play the guitar up here, you'd be like, blah, 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 not happening. The drums, even worse, right? The drummer, amazing what the drummer can do, right? But unity is something that, again, it takes coordination, a working together, all of it to happen. Ordinary work, again, for extraordinary days. The vision was brought to them. For our church, by the way, it's when we're working together in unity that it's our greatest apologetic to the world. Let that sink in. It's not an argumentation. It's when the people on the outside see that the people on the inside get along and they really love each other. I'm just curious. Some of you know this, but what did Jesus say? You will know my disciples if you praise. If you praise. No. You will know my disciples. You are my disciples if you build a big foyer. Is that what happens? No. If you love. If you love one another, this is what God's called us to do. And in Nehemiah, we see in verse 10, adjoining this, they're adjoined together. I want you to see they're right next to each other. So there had to be some good will towards your neighbor. I can't say all these names, but I want you to see the repairs of the opposite house, Jedidiah, Hattush. I love to call my kid Hattush. Hattush made repairs next to him. And then next to them, Mushulam, Berechiah, made the repairs opposite his living quarters. This is interesting too. Nehemiah knew something about motivation. You want to build a strong wall? Put the guy who lives next to the wall building the wall. You want to keep the robbers out? The enemy out? You're going to build a strong wall when it's right outside your door. Now, I can't imagine being a perfumer and saying like, "What? I'm going to booby trap my wall. I'm going to put a stink bomb in there. That will just throw them away." You know, I don't know what that's going to do, but This is a principle. You will never get beyond how you're getting along. You'll never get beyond how you're getting along. You can do that in your marriage, in your family, in your neighborhood, and here at church. You'll never get beyond how you're getting along. Every person is valuable. We're all different. We bring different things, but our common goals should outweigh our individual differences. A spirit of cooperation is then motivated by personal interest, and that's what Nehemiah saw. These people were actually motivated to change the wall, to build the wall. It was there already. It was planted in them. And when Nehemiah came along with his leadership, they rose up and said, "I'm going to do it. I'm committed." It brings me to the needs of our church. We put it on your seat, the connection card. It's this little yellow one. Everyone just grab one of these. I have to say this in church life. I haven't done it in a long time. Just grab one of these. If you don't have one, just look at this one up here and say, "I'll fill it out later." Okay? You can always do the QR code and fill it out online if you're a techie person. You know, everybody under 30. Okay. All right. So, you grab that thing and you say, what is it that Gateway needs? We need people investing in our kids right now. We don't have a huge kid staff. Miss Amy, she's out there doing stuff sometimes on her own. Because since COVID, we haven't really come back and served. Worship ministry, Pastor Dave and his team, the production ministry here, the greeters, the teardown and the setup. By the way, if you ever see Glenn Gerke out there, you know that when he sets up your chair, he's praying for you. He's thinking about you. He's caring for you. And sometimes he's the only guy here early in the morning to do that. Glenn, I just shouted out your name. I hope you're okay with that. He's so shy, he doesn't want to be even known. But that's what servants do. They serve humbly. What about you here at Gateway? What burden has he put on your heart? I know Fridays at 5, they're looking for people to pray for people at Fridays at 5. At Friday. Could that be you? Ask God to direct you and to help you serve here at Gateway. Here's the last point. Making a difference requires service and sacrifice. I don't get a lot of amens on this one. And I know it's hard because there are times I don't want to serve. Reminds me of the story of the man who is getting up in the morning and the wife comes in and says, "Look, you got to get up. It's time for church." He's like, I don't want to go there. I don't like those people." And she says, No. You don't understand. We're going to be late if you don't get up." "I don't care." He rolled over, pulled the blankets back. "I'm not going." And she said, "Honey, you have to go. You're the pastor." That didn't happen in my home, but there are days. There are days when it's heavy and I'm tired of dealing with conflict and I have to go to Jesus. And then I realize, he's the lead pastor. Amen. He's the one who's leading us. And then I can cast every burden that I feel from you, from my own life, onto him. I'm not saying this so you'll feel sad for me. I signed up for this gig. I understand it. But it means putting the needs of others and the mission at the front and the center of it all. It means living sufficiently and giving sacrificially. Nehemiah 3:5, it says, the section was repaired by the men of Tekoa, but their nobles would not put their shoulders to the work. Somebody say, uh-oh. Nehemiah noticed who wasn't working. Pastor, do you see that I'm not serving? Yeah. I'm challenging you the best I know how. Again, verse 27, next to them, the men of who? Tekoa, the Tekoites, or however you say that, repaired another section from the great projecting tower of the wall of Ophel. Some people do nothing. Some people refuse to work. That was the nobles that's mentioning here. Some are just like spectators. They're just fans. They're not followers, right? It's interesting. Again, he notices them, but on the other hand, some do way more than others, and he notices that too as a leader, and he's passing it on to us. They're working harder. The men of Tekoa. God, give me the men of Tekoa. God, give me just 10. Firing for you, passionate for you to go and work. Jesus said the fields are white unto harvest, but the workers, the ordinary everyday workers are few. Many say, you go, Ron.
You go, Ron. You go.
I want to say, you go. Listen, if you're asking for a personal invite for me to come to you personally, I'm saying this out loud right in front of you so you can hear me clearly. We need you. We cannot be us without you. Sounds really cool. Great Instagram post or whatever, but it's so true. Doesn't matter your age or your experience, we need you involved in church life. We need you connected in the life group. We need you connected with the ministry and serving regularly and giving of your time and your energy, your talents and your treasure here regularly. Why? The mission is critical. It's critical. Because it was just like a few weeks ago when I met someone coming through our doors whose parent, whose mom was praying for them, and they show up at our church. Mom's halfway, you know, across the country. And they come here and they find hope in the name of Jesus. Because of a lot of you who has given and served over and over again. Again, they shared a lot of the work, but some of these people traveled 26 miles to do the work. You think Aptos is far? The summit, right? They did it on foot. Some worked in less desirable places. Good example is that dung gate. We know it as the nursery. No, just kidding. I'm just saying, I've been in there and it smells bad sometimes, okay? All right, we love our babies. Don't get that, don't mess that up. Send that email to dan@gatewaybible.org. Yeah. It's a long list of names, but God acknowledges and he honors hard work. In Revelation, there's gonna be another book. It'll be open. And there'll be names in that book. Jesus on his way out of the earth, telling his disciples, I go to prepare a place for you. See, Jesus is building right now your place. And is your name going to be in that book? It may seem ordinary to you, just a list of names. Is it going to be there? Here's how I know your name can be in the book. When you surrender to Jesus and make him the Lord, the leader of your life, you recognize that you are a sinner, that Christ died for you on the cross to save you. And when you repent, turn around, go a different direction and follow him, he saves you. It's all a crazy process, all in one, made possible only by his grace, not anything you could do. We don't get saved by works, we're saved for works. That's what he saves us for. Again, these old stones that seem to be of no value, they remind us the stuff in your life that got toppled over by a poor decision and just sin in the world. Somebody hurts you deeply. It's just rubble to you. But God wants to take that back up, and that thing that seems like evil and destruction now be used as a tool of redemption. And he's doing it in some of you, and he wants to do it in more of you. Some of you say, well, I've been around church life for a long time. I have no zip, no passion. I'm stagnant. Get in the game. Stop complaining. Stop pointing fingers and be part of the solution. I love you, by the way. Get in the game. The coach is calling you off the bench. Get in the game. Serve. You can make coffee. You can put up a table. You can put up a chair. You can meet with middle school kids. You could go and teach a class. You can do all these things in the name of Jesus, but you got to get in the game. Mark 10:35, for even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to
serve.
Jesus came to serve, so you come to serve. That's the idea. I thought the service was the service. No, the service is for the Lord. That's why we're here. It's not for you to be served. We get that messed up. We're here to serve the Lord. Jesus came to build his church. He left one institution behind. It's the church. I know I've got friends. They don't go to church anymore. Oh, we meet in a small group, but kind of here and there. We're Christians. I'm telling you, you're missing out. You're missing out on what God wants to do in your life and how he wants to answer prayer in your life and how he wants to hold you accountable to things in your life. But God has created us to be, listen, an aircraft carrier, to get you stored up and to send you out. And that's what we want to do. We want to have you equipped before you go into the field. But you got to be a part of a body. God didn't save you to put you in a lazy boy and give you sweet tea to sip on. He saved you so that you, listen, could be a channel of salvation to our community. Little me? Yeah, let's pray. Father, I believe this strongly, that you are working in ways that I can't understand or see. Lord, with every head bowed to you and praying to you and honoring you by just bowing the head, Father, I ask, Lord, that you would work right now, Holy Spirit, on the hearts of people who have felt a tug. I haven't been involved like I should be. I've missed what Jesus really saved me for. And today I'm making a commitment, a personal commitment. I want to serve. I want to give. I want to be involved. I want to say yes to the mission of Jesus. And maybe you just need to get back to that, and that's you. Would you raise your hand? I want to pray for you, because this is a hard decision. And the enemy's working hard right now. If that's you, you're just saying, I want to make that personal commitment to get back involved again. Raise your hand right where you're at. Yeah? Okay. Father, we thank you, and it's with humble hearts we come before you and recognize that your mission is much larger than we could even comprehend. We thank you that right now you're stirring hearts and minds. You're drawing us to you as we focus on your word and what it means for our lives, for what it means here at Gateway Bible Church in 2023, to be a lighthouse, to be a hospital, be that aircraft carrier that sends people out. Father, we commit ourselves again as a church to you. Our lives are yours. In Jesus' name.